Hey everyone, Hellhawk here, or you may know me better as Zayx on the Shadowlands. This video will be another guide for the Eternal Championship. However, unlike my previous video where I was super geared with a maxed companion, and I showed how to take advantage of that to obtain the Sprint Champion achievement, this time I'll be showing how to complete all the bosses in the Eternal Championship for those of you with lesser gear, lower leveled companions, and less legacy unlocks. If you're interested in seeing a Sprint Champion guide, that video is linked in the description below. However, this guide will help you to progress beyond certain bosses if you're struggling with them, and even obtain your Deathless Champion achievement. There are four topics I want to discuss first before we jump straight into the fights that will help prepare you for the fights better. First, I want to go over legacy unlocks. These are acquired through doing various activities, such as completing conversation lines with your companions, collecting datacrons, completing class story chapters, or progressing alignments. These are very powerful and will help aid you in more than just single player content such as PvP and operations. The various datacrons and companion buffs from conversation lines will increase your stats significantly, giving you more endurance, mastery, crit, presence, and more. Completing story chapters on multiple characters of different classes will further improve your heroic moment, which is extremely helpful where survival is difficult, while providing you with better DPS options. If you've completed Light 5, or have 200,000 credits to burn, Unity is another great cooldown, providing 50% damage reduction for 15 seconds for you and your companion. For the sake of this video, since not all of you will have every class buff, every legacy buff, or Unity, an improved heroic moment, I'm not going to use my heroic moment, Unity, or any of my class buffs, just to put me on a more even playing field. The second topic to discuss is your companion. Your companion is your number two asset to beating the Eternal Championship. If survivability isn't an issue, you can actually have your companion DPS all the fights while you DPS as well, but that's beyond the scope of this guide, and that's better suited in my Sprint Champion guide, and if you're interested in that, I'd recommend you watch that over this. But if you're not in that situation, for the rest of you, if you're DPSing or tanking, your companion should be healing. While if you're healing, then your companion should be DPSing. I don't recommend you use a tank companion. If your companion is DPSing and you're melee, then your companion can be any choice, whether ranged or melee, but a ranged companion is preferred for the 9th fight, and a melee companion is a must for the 6th fight, unless you're looking to highly micromanage your companion. If your companion is healing, then I only recommend you use a ranged companion, as melee companions will move around once they decide to start DPSing a little if everybody's full with health, and this could push move them into a potentially compromising location, even though you may have set them in a different spot when you initially attacked. Ranged companions, when healing, are more likely to stay in their exact spot. Companion influence level is also very important, and the higher their influence, the vastly more powerful they will be. For example, in a test, my level 50 Ashara was capable of 5700 sustained DPS over 90 seconds without using her finisher. There's no reason to use a super low level companion. You can buy rank 1 and rank 2 companion gifts on your respective fleets and easily get a companion to influence 20 from influence 1 with only 92,000 credits, assuming you have all 3 Legacy of Altruism legacy unlocks, which only cost about 100,000 credits if I recall correctly. Those can be found in the character perk section. Alternatively, you can also trade in your common data crystals for rank 6 gifts to the vendor on Odessen. For this video, I will be having Kaleo heal for me since she is ranged and of a low influence level. She's only level 4 for me, but since of all my legacy buffs, she's equivalent to a level 15 for someone who has 0 legacy presence increase. And if you didn't know, 50 presence is the equivalent of 1 influence level. The third topic I want to discuss is gear and consumables. Gear is important, very important. Still, in my opinion, not as important as your companion or your skill and class knowledge. In my previous video, I had a mix of 220 and 224 gear, which you can see here. Chances are, though, if you're struggling, your gear isn't from hard mode and nightmare operations. So to put me on an even playing field, I've decided to wear rating 200, non-moddable, non-augmented blue gear. I chose this gear because the Eternal Championship drops non-moddable 204 gear, and from a progression standpoint, non-moddable 200 gear would be the next step down. Also, 200 blue gear drops randomly throughout playing the chapters of Knights of the Fallen Empire, so it's not that hard to obtain while playing, and you have to have beaten Chapter 9 to be here to begin with. I did try 190 green gear, and that's from Mission Rewards, and drops more often during coffee, but found that without using any of the things I noted earlier, and a low-level companion, I just couldn't survive certain fights. But with 200 gear, I was able to survive all fights without dying. I was able to get all my 200 rating gear for just under 350,000 credits off the GTN. The more expensive items, of course, were the implants, the earpiece, and the relics, since they were crafted by other players. And the Focus Retribution and Serendipitous Assault are your more expensive relics, but those are the two that you should be using. Make sure to fill the slots, the crystal slots, on your main hand offhand. Crit, in most cases, should be the crystal that you choose. Now, this statement's obvious, but the better your gear, the easier the content will be. So if you're rocking gear under rating 200, or even rating 200 gear, and you have the means to replace it, I highly recommend you do it before trying to beat this content or trying to beat certain bosses that you continually struggle on. Now, this is gear and consumables, so I'm also going to discuss consumables, which are highly recommended and very valuable to being able to progress in this content, and they're cheap and powerful too. Chilled Corellian Cocktail is inexpensive, and you can find it in the Fleet Cantina vendor for somewhere around 500 to 1,000 credits. I'm not sure what the exact price is exactly, but it's not a lot, and it'll add the equivalent to an influence level and a half to your companion for 30 minutes, but unfortunately when you die it does disappear, so you'll have to reapply it. Another thing you can use, in case you need more DPS healing or survivability in a pinch, is an adrenal. Now, I only have attack adrenals here, but if you're healing, triage adrenals, and if you're looking for an extra cooldown, it's called an absorb adrenal. Don't use anything too flashy. Blue polybiotics are more than enough for this content. Now, even if you don't use those two, you should absolutely be using a stim, and you shouldn't use anything less than advanced polybiotic stim. They last 8 hours of playtime, so if you log out, they don't continue, and they persist through defeat. While only costing about 7,000 to 9,000 credits on the GTN per item, depending on the server that you're on. Now, in most cases, you should be using a versatile stim. If you're tanking, you can use either a versatile or a fortitude stim. But if you're a DPS and you haven't met your accuracy cap, which is 110% accuracy in any category, then you should be using the proficient stim. Please note, though, that tanks and healers don't need any accuracy. By the way, for reference, my tertiary stat distribution is completely arbitrary, but I went with this distribution, as you can see, about 697 crit, 246 alacrity, and 369 accuracy. As you can see, I'm significantly below the accuracy cap. 684 is the goal if you have the 1% legacy buff. If you don't, it's higher, and unfortunately I don't know the exact number. But this, in my situation, I should be using the proficient stim. If you have 110% melee ranged force or tech accuracy, then use a proficient stim. Now, since not everyone will use consumables, I'm not going to either, just to show that it's doable, albeit challenging and still not recommended at all. Now, the final thing I want to discuss is your class knowledge and skill. This is your number one asset to completing the Eternal Championship. Play whatever class you feel comfortable with, it doesn't matter, whatever you're most comfortable with is what you're going to succeed best on. But make sure you read your tooltips in your class discipline and your abilities pane as well. This will help you understand how your class works, as well as useful cooldowns that can save your life in case you're close to dying or taking a lot of damage way too quickly. If you don't fully understand your class or rotation, you can go to dolphy.net and read up on some class guides there. Make sure you become more familiar with your class. Another great thing to do is to parse, and you can use the dummies over on the Zeos Shadow Imp side or the Gav Daragon pub side if you don't have one on your personal starship, and use those to practice your rotation. All this will help you to become a better player, and will make doing content such as this, as well as other content in the game, significantly easier if you're struggling at all or if you're doing endgame content. As a final warning, the only disciplines I recommend not playing for this is Deception Sin, Infiltration Shadow, concealment operative, or scrapper scoundrel. And the only reason is because these rotations become greatly neutered from positional requirements, and you're not able to stealth out mid-fight. Now, some of you may think, oh, you can use a tank companion, but in most cases, your tank companion cannot hold aggro if you're doing your rotation right. And that's not something that you want to have to deal with, so try to stay away from those disciplines. Though you won't be able to DPS as much, and the longer you have to DPS, the longer you have to try and survive. So DPS directly affects survivability in this. Now, with all that introductory mumbo jumbo done, let's get into the fights. This video was initially 52 minutes long when trying to do it without cutting, so I'll be skipping dialogue and transitions in the fights, but you can look below in the description for timestamps if you want to skip ahead to specific fights. The first boss you face is Arlaya Zacin. She's not difficult at all, but she does have two adds that buff her. The first add on the left buffs her health, a healing taken, and you have to kill that before you can actually really put any damage to her, no matter how good your gear is. The second add buffs her damage output, and it's imperative that you kill that off first so that your companion can actually keep up with healing you. Once you've taken them both down, you can kill off Arlaya Zacin pretty easily. So I'll go ahead and start the fight and show that how it works. So that green bar and that red bar, the green one's the healing buff, the red one's the DPS buff. As you can see, I'm losing a lot of health. But now that he's dead, healing me is not going to be an issue for my companion anymore. Now both the adds are dead, I can finish up on Zacin and easily kill her. Now for the second fight, you're fighting Darula Grah. He has adds that I'm just going to AoE down. Now Darula Grah will throw a grenade on me, and I'll just move out of the way so that I can easily DPS Darula Grah without being in range of that. I'm going to pull him a certain distance away so that my companion is also going to be outside those grenade range no matter where I am. So now my companion will end up just staying there, which will make this significantly easier. Now here's the toxic grenade, that's when you want to move. Make sure you pull the adds off your companion when they come out. They'll most likely aggro to your companion first if they're healing. As you saw, there was a dodge there, so that's the problem with not having a full accuracy. Is that they can miss your attacks can miss, and when that happens, that's a huge DPS loss. Especially if it's, let's say, one of your best abilities with a long cooldown. The third boss you'll face is Gungus Boga, and he constantly spawns out adds called Heralds of Zildrog. For the most part, you can just AoE them down. If they get a little overwhelming though, you should focus them as they'll do a lot of damage. Gungus Boga will eventually suck you into the center. As soon as you're not stuck anymore, just go ahead and move away from that. Now you can move them to wherever you want as well, but as far as position is on this, it doesn't really matter too much. So this is where he jumps into the center and you'll see he stuns me, and he'll pull in your companion too. Just move out of the center. And you can keep DPSing too, while you wait for him to do his attack. As you can see, he just spawned another herald. So I'll just dot spread and AoE them down. Yeah.
I remind all hails and Zildron that this was a sanctioned fight complete with Death Wing.
Boss 4 is Conrad, Omwert, and Chompers, and this is the first fight where you get a swap mechanic. Now, I'm just going to have my I'm going to pull from out here so that my companion stays far away from the center where there'll be different circles dropped that I want to avoid. Your first goal is to get Chompers to 30% as fast as possible. Once Chompers is at 30%, he'll be incapacitated and you want to DPS Conrad. Now, adds will spawn out, make sure that you kill them as fast as possible as they will apply buffs while DPSing your companion. Once Chompers is back up, make sure you attack Chompers again and bring them to 30%. Only kill Conrad when Chompers is incapacitated, as that will auto-kill Chompers. The other way around will cause an enrage. So I'll go ahead and pull from here, so that my companion stays there. And I'll do some AoE too, as you can damage Conrad. So there's the first thing you want to avoid, is a slam. It will stun you and your companion. So also the acid puddle, which will add a dot, and then that red circle will add a stun. Now, we switch to Conrad because the worm is down, but also adds have spawned out, so I want to make sure I want to pick those up as fast as possible. They don't have a lot of health, so they'll go down pretty quickly. Use cooldowns if you have to, if you're low on health. Or kite. So I'm gonna run a cooldown here, because I am low on health.
They're killing you, ugly beast.
Master is dead. A day to remember in the Arena Grand.
Now, boss 5 is Lanos. It is the first really challenging boss that you're going to have to fight, and there's multiple phases to this fight that keep repeating. So I'm going to try and have my companion stand kind of in the middle when I pull. And what you're first going to do is just DPS Lanos as much as possible. You'll eventually spawn these shield droids that shield him. But the good news is you don't actually have to kill them or interrupt them. You can actually do a knockback or some type of AoE hit, such as smash if you're a marauder, to keep them from shielding Lanos. From there, you can AoE them down as they will focus DPS on your companion, and with everything else that happens in this fight, you're going to need to kill them as much as possible. The second set of adds that he spawns will spawn somewhere on the sides. You need to also focus them down fast because they will DPS your companion, and it'll put a strangle on the amount of heals you can receive. And then the third type of add he spawns is these shock droids that will stun you momentarily, leap to you, and then you need to get out of their blast range or they'll kill you. You're going to have to run heavy cooldowns in this fight, and if necessary, make sure you hit up a healing station. Ideally, you hit up a healing station no more than 0 to 1 time, because you only get 4 throughout the entire Eternal Championship. So I'm going to do my best to not need one at all. So I'm going to go ahead and pull from about here.
Rise and shine.
I'm going to set myself up back here, so I can just back up and knock them back and then dot spread. And should cancel the shield. Now the adds are out, I'm gonna focus them down quickly. Now make sure you get out of these blast ranges, or you will die. Now that the shielders are back, I'm gonna do the same thing as before. Although, I should first have him dotted up before spreading. I'm gonna pop one cooldown here to help me out.
Is that your best?
Go ahead and pop another cooldown. and another cooldown. Like I said, it's a hard fight, and you need all the help you can give to your companion. Now, when he dies, any shield troopers still alive will automatically die, but these guys won't, so you need to make sure you finish them off. So not an easy fight, and you definitely need to use your cooldowns as much as possible to survive, the lower your companion's influence level. Now, boss 6 is the Breaktown Brawler, and this one throws a lot of people for a loop. The best way to do this, when you have a healing companion in your melee, is to have your companion focus one of the adds. I usually go for King Crush, but that's just because that's what I've been doing. It doesn't matter which one you tell your companion to go for. Now, while your companion's focusing them, you want to grab aggro of the Breaktown Brawler, and you want to grab aggro of one of the other adds and DPS down the add. Now, stay in range, healing range of your companion, and if for some reason you find yourself low on heals, you can either hit a station, or you can kite the main guy or one of the adds and let your companion heal you back up. Ideally, you want to take as few strikes from this guy as possible while DPSing down this guy, so you're going to be playing a little bit of Ring Around the Rosie. I'll try to show it the best I can, and I'll try not to use a taunt, since not everybody will have a taunt. Now just remember, if you're outside these circles when you attack them, with the exception of dots, it will reflect back the damage on you, which will you'll find yourself dying very quickly. So I'm just going to manually tell my companion to attack Crush, and I will not attack Crush at all. Since your companion's a healer, they'll start to grab aggro just through heals on the other people, so just make sure you periodically do damage to them, and if you do have access to taunts, use it. Just note, if you're a DPS, the AoE taunt is actually a threat drop.
You and me?
Also, don't have the two adds on top of each other, as they'll start enraging. So as you can see, it's a little bit of a dizzying experience. Just make sure that if you do any AoE onto Breakdown Brawler, you get in his circle too. Otherwise, he will reflect that to you. And when he's casting like this, don't stand on top of the circle that Breakdown Brawler has, as he will launch you as well as launching this ad. Now, when he's also casting up, he'll resist your attacks, so there's no reason to go in and try and attack him. With AoE, he won't reflect it to you. Now, this is a problem. The adds are on top of each other, so I need to make sure this ad leaves it as soon as possible. Get close enough to him to start pulling him away, otherwise he'll do what you just saw, where he pounds his chest. Don't take him on while he's enraged like that. Now that Ripper's dead, I'm going to help my companion with Crush. I can taunt if I want, to make it easier so Khalil only has to heal one person. But since, like I said, not everybody will have a taunt, I'm just not going to do that. Now you see these stacks I have building up on my debuff bar? That's from the melee, from being in range of Breakdown. He'll do more DPS to you as you gain more stacks, so ideally you let those stacks lower by not being in a circle. Like I said earlier, if healing gets a little out of control, all you have to do is kite.
Make you dead.
I'll kill you.
So he he's casting up again. I'm gonna stay out of the circle so I don't get knocked. But he will kick around and crush.
Make you dead. I'll kill you.
When he starts casting up on that, all you gotta do is run out of range to break the cast. As you can see, I'm building up a lot of stacks. So I can either run some cooldowns, which I'll run one. Just a simple damage reduction. So for this situation, all you have to do is make your companion passive, but I lost my mouse on the screen. And they'll move out of the way and he'll stop his cast. Just make sure you don't forget to unpassive them. So what he did was a threat drop to me. So all you gotta do is DPS him enough to regain aggro. Or taunt him. So it's not too bad of a fight, it's just management of your position. And how much heals you're taking, so you can kite and staying out of the circles when you need to and in the circles when you need to. So I'm doing boss 6 again, this time from a range perspective. The strategy will remain pretty much the same. I'm gonna have Kaleo, who's two influence levels lower on this tune than my other one. She's gonna focus King Crush. So Kaleo's a 2 on this tune, equivalent of a 13 for somebody with no presence, legacy unlocks, like I have. While I'll be trying to maintain as much aggro as possible on Thades and Mr. Ripper, and DPSing them quite a bit. It's a little bit harder on a range tune, obviously, because I'm not as mobile, so my DPS abilities while trying to ignore Thades' attacks will be a little bit harder. Not to mention, I don't have dot spreading because I'm playing a burst spec, and if you're outside of range, I don't have any taunts either, so if Thades goes onto Kaleo, I have to get into his range and attack him. So it's a lot more trickier, it's a lot trickier of a fight to do, but it's very doable. Just to kind of give myself some balance, I've dropped my buffs again and my stim. And as for gear, I just dropped my implants earpiece and I swapped out belt bracers with some stuff I picked up on the way. So I'm back down to 60k health again like my Sin was. It's not 100% equivalent, but it's about there. And so I'll go ahead and have Kaleo pull Crush. I'm gonna move her up a little bit. Pull him there.
Make you
hit him with a net.
All right, make me look good.
Just put a few attacks on him to grab aggro.
Kill you.
And try and grab Ripper while I'm at it. Just be careful to cancel out your attacks when he punches them. I'm just popping this cooldown for the extra DPS I can get out of it.
Yeah,
I believe I've outranged Kaleo's heals. So I'll hit myself with a heal and I'll kite a little bit so I can get some heals. Come on, Kaleo, be nice to me.
I'll kill you.
He's not happy. Do need to try and move them into Kaleo's heal range. That's better. Plus side is they won't pull aggro from Kaleo due to her heals. The downside is I'll die. That's not what I want to press at all. I was outside of range on that hit. Trying to get back into Kaleo's heal range, so I'm kiting again.
You dead.
rise and shine.
So as you can see, you take a lot more damage as a range, because I gotta stand still like that every once in a while. Not to mention that if they get knocked out of range, your attacks can continue. And you can accidentally reflect on yourself. So again, just moving into heal range of Leo. I can pass this for her if I want to reposition her better. But I'm kind of too lazy to do that. I'm just going to DPS Thades until he goes to launch me, and then I'll go finish off Crush. Actually, I need to move out for heals, so I am dying. Well, that was a waste. I need to move out of his range again because I have 30 stacks. It's way too many. I've actually pulled aggro on King Crush. It's good because I can position him and Kaleo can start focusing me for heals instead of both me and her, changing her ability to triage well. Full health, let my stacks kind of calm down. I even lost threat on him actually. So now I'm gonna passive Kaleo just so I can stop the cast of Untouchable. Make sure you unpassive her. Bad, can't tell your companions if I drop at times. That's alright. So as you can see, doable. I've finally gained aggro back on him. Just a lot more challenging when ranged. Due to the inability to constantly be able to attack. That not having a taunt is certainly a big difference. But hopefully you found that helpful. Boss 7 is Nocturnal and Raven. Nocturnal's the one with the little tank symbol above them. You want to make sure you kill them last. If you kill them first, Raven enrages and you get wiped. But Raven will jump around various locations and drop mines. Your companion will be unaffected by any of this. And the mines are, if you're in the mine, you'll be stunned. But you want to make sure you position the mine so that Nocturnal gets stunned. Nocturnal will do a lot of DPS to you otherwise, so make sure you're not in melee range of Nocturnal. Raven will eventually spawn out some droids that will try to kidnap your companion. Make sure you get into melee range of them and kill the strong droid as fast as possible to make all the droids built a blow up. Otherwise, they'll kill your companion. They're essentially kidnappers. Now, you can actually interrupt that, but you have to be really fast to react to it. So I'll go ahead. I'm going to pull with my companion about in the center here, so no matter where I am, my companion will be able to heal me.
Yeah.
Do know you can hard stun both of them. You just can't do a stun that breaks on damage. So I'm gonna stun her. Whoop, wrong button. Just because she was doing some extra DPS to me. I want to make sure that wasn't going to be an issue. So there was the companion abduction, you saw I interrupted it. But he'll still be able to call it again anyway. So now that they're out, you want to kill the strong, which is the abductor. And you want to get in the melee range of him. Otherwise, he'll reflect damage, the ult reflect damage on you. You can also interrupt this guy from doing anything. Once you kill him, just go back to focusing on Raven. Make sure you move out of those cones too. Now once you kill him, make sure you pick up this pack, Nocturnal Wind Rage, so just pop a Stunning Mine, and also pop the Shark Repellent. You can use this to move, do not press the far right one. The far right one will get you will get your companion abducted, and it's not ideal. So to be safe, I'm gonna run a melee range cooldown here. So I hopefully take some less damage. I'm also gonna stun Nocturne on my own. But you can also throw mines out, and you probably should. And kite Nocturne into them once they turn white. Nocturne will hit you super hard, so you have to be really careful. Even kiting doesn't always work. Boss 8 is Minkus and Little Gut. Although you actually never fight Minkus at all, you will just fight Little Gut and Apprentice Handlers. So we'll just only focus on Little Gut from the start. The main things to avoid is there's a giant red circle he puts first, so I'm gonna plant my companion a little further back so I don't get them hitting it. There'll be a yellow circle that you can't avoid. There'll be a red set of bars that come out, you wanna avoid that. And he'll also knock you around, which I'll show during the fight and try to avoid. So if your companion picks up an aggro, you can just DPS and try to move the guy back. Or taunt if you have that ability. Now unfortunately, I'm going to get hit by that because I burned my horse speed. And it's a large amount of damage that you take, so don't do that. Now when the handlers come out, make sure you DPS them down fast. Otherwise, after a certain amount of time, they'll start buffing Little Gut. A Little Gut will stun you and throw you. Ideally, you want to position yourself so you don't get put in the only quadrant that's got some type of damage going to it. Now here's the red bar I was mentioning about avoiding. Now the reason I'm jumping there is it resets your position on the server. If you don't jump, sometimes the server hasn't updated enough, and even though you're out of it on your screen, you're not out of it according to the server. And you'll still get a hit by it. I'm just gonna pop a cooldown there for safekeeping. But this way, he's gonna, based on my position, he throws me into the non-quadranted area. Blast it. Fortunately, I still got tossed back into it, but only for a brief second. Now, the other thing is you want to micromanage your companion, which I just did a horrible job of, and now I need to run cooldowns like crazy. If your companion's in that, make sure you passive your companion. That's the best way to move your companion. Luckily, though, it didn't cost me. Yeah, just hit passive for your companion, and you can pull them to wherever you are, then unpassive them, and they'll stand at that location. Until you micromanage. So our ninth boss is the return of Arleia Zacin as Doom Droid. And again, this is a boss where you want to pull with your companion out a little bit, because there will be various AoE and other circles that Doom Droid will drop that you want to make sure your companion doesn't get hit by, because they will hurt your companion. And there'll be adds that spawn. There'll be these big Droidica looking guys. You can kill them and make sure you want to do that fast, because they'll start DPSing you and your companion, putting out a lot of damage. And these little R2-D2 looking guys that will blow up, so you want to make sure you have that happen away from your companion. And they'll also slow you when they do, so make sure you have some type of speed boost available to get out of the circles for that. And I'll go ahead and pull. There's one other phase, which I'll kind of explain as it comes. The important thing is that you get aggro from this guy in the beginning, because he will have this giant laser that he shoots out. You want to avoid, and you want to make sure your companion doesn't get hit by it either. Just run through him to avoid it. Afterward, he does some additional heavy hitting attacks. It's alright, your companion should be healing you. But these are what you want to avoid. As you progress in the fight, the circles will get bigger. So just keep that in mind for your positioning. Now after he does those, this is when he will spawn the droids. At first it's just one and one, so it's not too much of a challenge. So we'll just kill this guy real quick. I just had a bad lag spike. So pop a cooldown. I'm gonna go ahead and hit up a heal station to be safe. Although I think my companion would have gotten me up. Now here's the other phase. You can keep DPSing him for a brief second. But now he's got a shield up. And as you see, I got 20 seconds to kill all these other droids, which is plenty of time to do so. Just use fillers and whatever. Once you kill them all, he'll continue to cast. But once time is low, you can reapply dots. Go back to DPSing. Once the shield visibly disappears, you can do damage to him. If you don't kill him in that time, he'll basically one-shot him. So I don't get another lag spike in this part. Here, Arleia Zacin is very vain about her looks. So I believe the reason I'm not getting too many heals there is I've outranged Leo a little bit. So I'm just gonna move a little bit so that hopefully she can heal me back up. So I think I potentially pulled her too far is what I'm getting at. So he's going back into this again, so again we'll just kill these guys as fast as possible. Otherwise he'll kill us in the end. We don't want that. And you can reapply dots. It just won't tick for damage. Now at this point he should be spawning two of each droid. I'm just gonna finish off the boss real quick.
Systems.
No revenge for you, Sizzling. Victory to the mysterious stranger! Next stop,
as you can see, my companion is having trouble keeping up with healing herself just with these two droids. There you have it, boss 9. So the final boss on our way to Deathless Champion, as well as just beating the Eternal Championship in general, is Aftershock and Zotar. Now, I did use one heal terminal already, so I have three left for doing this. I'm going to try and pull with Kaleo about here, which will make it easier for having her dodge the different laser droids that I need to figure out ways to defeat. Zotar himself, basically the fight is get this guy to 50. Zotar pops out, kills Zotar for a bit, he goes back in, brings Aftershock back to 50, Zotar pops out, bring him to 50, he jumps center, and then the shocking finale commences. I'll kind of go over the fight as it's happening to save time here. So make sure you dodge the Fury Motors. The good thing about that is they don't hurt your companion at all, but they will hurt you a lot. Now you can actually interrupt for the deployed droids. I just wasn't paying attention to or thinking about it when it happened, so I didn't get the deploy out. And you can get the droids to blow themselves up, as well as Fury Mortar will blow up the droids too. Gotta be careful, the mortar will also blow up your heal stations. I'm just gonna try and get these guys to kill each other. Not sure how worth that was, but tried it anyway. Now Zotar's out, so we'll be focusing Zotar. Go ahead and stun break when he stuns you. Now we want a DPS Aftershock down. The first thing he's going to do is hit us with a laser. So we need to hit a pretty good cooldown for this. So I'm going to burn Shroud, which will last for about 5 seconds. Once that's over and I start getting low, I'm going to hit up the heal station over here. Otherwise you will die. Now Gravity Mine will suck you into the center. Should bring your companion into the center too, I believe. Do not remember. Doesn't look like it did, so I was wrong there. Do note if you take too long to DPS him back down to 50, he'll laser you again. And here it comes. But should be able to break it. There we go. Now we just worry about Zotar. Now when we get Zotar to 50, he's gonna jump mid and cast up what's called a shocking finale. And we'll just stun him right here when he starts the shocking finale. Make sure your companion's inside this area, otherwise your companion will actually die to this. Go ahead and interrupt his autopilot to delay getting attacked from Aftershock. Of course, you can only interrupt it so many times. And you have to not get hit by it. I got hit by it, so I'm probably doomed. Popped another cooldown. At this point, find a safe spot. Here's one. Everything will die.
All right, make me look good.
And that's completing the 10th boss. So I hope you found this video to be helpful, and if you were struggling at all, hopefully it gave you some ideas for ways to beat the bosses if there was something that you didn't understand about it, or something with maybe your gear setup or your companion that you need to switch around to help. If you have any questions, if you have any comments, feel free to leave them in the video below, and I'll try to answer as many as possible to the best of my ability. Otherwise, good hunting.